auditing standards, guidelines, and ethical codes. It's been about 7 or 8 years since the exam changed in 2016. The code of ethics hasn't been on the exam since. Back then, the code of ethics was on every exam. Wasn't it paper-based back then? It was a written, paper-based exam. The code of ethics hasn't been on the exam for ages now. Now it's mostly about auditing standards. Auditing standards, especially for new systems. This particular slide. It's crucial. Read it over and over, at least 10 to 20 times. But why, you asked? Read it often, and understanding will come. Some students, though, skip classes and readings, and rush to exercises without watching lectures. Then they run into trouble. I swear, sometimes. It leaves us teachers speechless. We've stressed this approach time and again. On this matter, I'd like to think I have some expertise here. So, here's the thing. My advice to you all is this. Do your best to follow what the teacher says. He simply doesn't pay attention in class. Or he doesn't take the lesson seriously at all. Then he just jumps into doing the problems. He barely understands any of the questions. So what can you do about it? It can be pretty helpless sometimes, you know? So why emphasize reading more? Because most of our questions revolve around this point. They're all about summarizing what's on this slide. What's an auditor's job? First off, understand what auditors actually do. Make sure we're following all the legal and contract rules. Got it. So you check if we're following the laws and regulations. You check if we're sticking to the rules. But, what's the second thing you check? You check if we're following our internal policies. The laws are external and mandatory. The policies are internal. External laws and regulations are mandatory. And what about the internal stuff? Governance and management policies. Wouldn't you agree? So what exactly do you audit and verify? You check if the company adheres to its various policies. What's next on the list? The first two aspects we discussed. Deal with the big picture. Don't you think? And the next step involves focusing on specific details. Let me break it down for you. This reflects an auditor's approach to analysis. Start broad, then narrow down to specifics and individual cases. Let me illustrate with an example. Then you'll see what I mean. Let's see. There's this village, right? This village says, "We are China." They call themselves China's premier village, you know? Now, imagine. Well, our village is incredibly rich. This village of ours, you see. You follow. We're number one in everything, across the board. So, what's your role here? You're an auditor, right? Isn't that correct? Your job is to verify if they really are China's top village. So what's your approach? You need to inspect and test things. What exactly are you checking? First off, legal compliance. Are all their activities and businesses lawful? You wouldn't want the whole village to be drug dealers, right? Like what happened in Guangdong years ago. Entire villages were in the drug trade, one after another. That is that, no doubt about it. First, we need to check if they're breaking any laws or regulations. What's the next thing to consider? What makes this village think it's the best in China? What's their basis for claiming to be so rich? Let's start by examining your villages. What do you call it, rules? You know, the policies. Got it. So, what kind of policies are we talking about here? Alright. Free education for all students. The village funds education from preschool to college. Next up, healthcare is on the house. Third, you get a roof over your head at no cost. And fourth, food's on the table, free of charge. You with me so far? Now, if all these perks are in place, what does that mean? It shows, big picture-wise, that this village stands out from the rest. But, then, what's next? We zoom in on the details. We check if these policies actually work on the ground. It's not enough to have a policy that's poorly implemented. So we approach it from the macro level down to the micro. and finally, down to the individual level. So how do we verify this? Through surveys and site visits, right? We target specific villagers and, well, we interview some village officials. We need to verify things, correct? During this process, we gather on-site evidence to investigate. For instance, their education, right? Is it really free or not? Are their medical costs fully covered? Is their housing really provided for free? So, you see, what's the key to an auditor's mindset? Remember, big picture first, then details. Then zoom in on specific cases or examples. This approach is absolutely critical. Keep this in mind for your exams. Don't jump straight into specific chats. Starting with individual samples is wrong. These are all incorrect approaches. Start by examining the overall situation. Check for legal compliance first, if applicable. Then, review the company's diverse policies and procedures. And check the correctness of strategies. Next, examine the practical evidence related to these policies and procedures. Finally, focus on specific samples and individual case studies. Remember, most exam questions are essentially condensed versions of these key points. It's crucial to review this information multiple times. Make sure to read it thoroughly more than once. When you face difficulties during the exam, remind yourself of an auditor's role. Inspect and test, but what exactly? Focus on these four key points. The audit procedure. Collect evidence according to this audit framework. Assess internal control effectiveness using evidence. Compile the audit report. Report witnesses to stakeholders. Propose recommendations and remedies. Right. So, what does this all mean? Well, it's the audit process we're discussing. Start with planning. What's involved in planning? It's a risk-based approach. Field work documentation. You see, it's all about implementation. Post-implementation involves reporting and follow-ups. This phase covers reporting and follow-up actions. Then we have audit and construction standards. These standards encompass diverse legal regulations. Correct. Industry regulations are involved, aren't they? And of course, best practices. What role do these best standards play? They serve as your audit standards and requirements. Within the framework of general execution report standards. Alright, we've covered those three parts. Moving on. Now, about professional ethics. Let's briefly review. I recall there's something about not defaming, I think. Industry associations and whatnot. If you're taking the ISACA exam, you can't badmouth ISACA. Certified members should do this and that and so on and so forth. Like not trash-talking their professional association. Just skim through it. Anyway, they haven't been testing professional ethics in recent years. A glance is all you need.